start the day a series of messages on the world in which Jesus was born. We think sometimes we live in a fearful world. Quite honestly, we live in a very peaceful world compared to what Jesus was born into. As we celebrate Christmas this year, we need to take a close look and pause to remember the world in which Christ was born. I know that oftentimes we sing different things, we have no idea what they're going through. Because you see, they live in a world of real, real political corruption, of real social injustice, of real religious apathy. Why did I put real before all those? Because we like to think we have it worse than anybody ever had it before in history. We don't. Luke 2:1-3. It came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria, and all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. You think you've got problems with your tax in the mail? I mean, let me go back to the place of your birth to register there, not knowing how much tax you're going to owe. But you see, part of the problem was the political powers was three men that were running the world at that day. And we're going to look at all three of these men today. Caesar Augustus, Cyrenius, and not in that passage over in the book of Matthew, we find Herod the Great. Caesar Augustus came to power by killing all his political opponents. Now that's a real lecture, isn't it? He lived a greedy lifestyle off the resources he got from captives of his many wars. Whenever he needed to have a little bit more money for whatever reason he thought, he'd just go out and start another war and take their wealth and spend it. Cyrenius here is another character, though. We know very little about him, except he's a Roman aristocrat who changed allegiance almost as often as he changed his garments. Whoever came into power, Cyrenius went and made friends with him. Because you see, Cyrenius' whole activity was his own survival, was his only real interest. He did nothing for the people. He only just went from politician to politician to see how he could survive. Now you say, we could live with greed. We could live with that kind of thing. But you see, there was also another local politician by the name of Herod. He was known as Herod the Great. He was king of Judea, a man of unusual and ruthless geopolitical talent. Whatever it took to survive, he had it figured out. He was one step ahead of everybody else of his day. He was a bystander at the assassination of Caesar in 44. My wife said, what BCE stand for? Before the Christian era. And then he poisoned his royal father in 43. A year after Caesar was assassinated, He said, hey, they got away with that. Maybe I can kill my dad and get away with that. He managed to consolidate his power by 37, in part through the killing of 45 Sadducean priests who opposed the opposition of him being there. 45 Jewish men assassinated because they dared to stand up and say, Herod, you meant not our king. By integrating himself with the ever-changing leaders of the Roman Empire, Herod preserved his autonomy to practice brutal authoritarianism in local politics. It's interesting, he was more interested in what we call local politics than he was in world politics. But his local politics included the entire nation of Israel. As a non-Jew, he was a Gentile, he appropriated the mantle of King of the Jews for himself. Here it was like so many dictatorial rulers throughout history, a paranoid populace, acutely aware of the power of public opinion. And he swayed it very well for himself. He built theaters, fortresses, altars throughout Judea, and an amphitheater in Jerusalem, all to buy popular legitimacy and proclaim his greatness. He also, the temple that was there in the time when Jews were known as Herod's temple. Herod helped to build the temple for the Jewish people. He knew how to keep his subjects happy. He also married a Jewish woman. I always get her name wrong. Marna Mina? Meaning? They had two sons, Alexander and Aristarchus, though he later killed all three of them because they threatened his rule. Gentlemen, I don't suggest that with your wife. But you see, after we live in a more peaceful time, and when the rulers of our country can kill all these people like nothing's going on, if they just threatened who they thought they were. In modern geopolitical parlance, Herod's ability to anticipate and manage a complex threat matrix preserved his power. He always knew it was going to happen before it happened, and he dealt with it. He was a very intelligent man, very corrupt at the same time. He was close to 60 years old. He was fearful of any threat to his power. Briefly, King Herod the Great died in 4 BC amid political turmoil and religious unrest. Not only was there political corruption going on, social injustice was rampant. Roman culture lived in luxury and privilege. In fact, it's kind of interesting, the Apostle Paul used his Roman citizenship to keep himself out of trouble at one time. In Acts chapter 22, it says this, and as they bound him with thongs Paul said unto the centurion that stood by, is it lawful for you to scourge a man that is a Roman and uncondemned? And when the centurion heard this, he went and told the chief captain, saying, take heed what you're doing, for this man is a Roman. And the chief captain came and said to him, tell me, art thou a Roman? He said, yea. Then straightway they departed from him, which should have examined him. And the chief captain also was afraid, after he knew that he was a Roman, because he had bound him. Just putting cuffs on him was the wrong thing to do, because he was a Roman, uncondemned. By the time you get to chapter 23, it's kind of interesting because there's a cover-up in here. Listen to what this captain now tells the authorities. This man was taken by the Jews and should have been killed by them, or of them. Then came I with an army and rescued him, having understood that he was a Roman. Who was it that really came and grabbed him and was about to do him harm? That captain. Cover-ups aren't new either. The Jewish culture, living among the Roman culture, however, was quite different. They were oppressed and considered less than human. Ordered around like animals. When Rome said jump, they said how high. Joseph and Mary were pawns in the hands of the corrupt governments. Whatever they said, they had to do. They said, go back to your home of origin, figure out how much money we could make in taxes from you. They had to pull up sticks and go from Nazareth to Bethlehem. The interesting thing that Israel is actually a nation of farmers. Many lost their farms due to high taxes and low income. In those days, taxes were paid in crops and animals. The Roman centurions would come by and say, I see you have 100 animals here. I'll take 50 of them for tax. When you lose 50% of your resources on a regular basis, because a month later, another guy comes by and says, oh, I see you got 50. I'll take 25 of them. And I see you have a nice crop here of wheat. We're going to take half of it. We're going to take three-quarters of it. Farmers were broke, working very hard to pay taxes and not survive themselves. I found an interesting book that I really have enjoyed. It's called Liberation of Christmas by Richard Corson. A book about the social and political climate at the time of Jesus' birth. Check this quote out about Caesar. Caesar was so tax hungry that if someone couldn't pay, the Romans would force the peasants to go back home, farm the land again, even though they left because they couldn't make it. Can you imagine a country, a government, would tell you that even though you're failing in your business, you can't close your business, you've got to continue to do it? It was for tax reasons Mary and Joseph headed to Bethlehem, according to the story of Jesus born, birth in the Gospel of Luke. Far from Rome, the Emperor Caesar Augustus had demanded a census be taken of all his conquered lands so he might know how he could collect more taxes. His tax collectors weren't getting enough. He made everybody go back to their home of origin to find out how he could do this. Richard Huxley also had an interesting thing. I never heard this before. He suspects that Joseph, cast in the biblical literature as a carpenter and woodworker, was actually a downward mobile peasant who lost his land as a farmer. He was not a carpenter by trade, he was a farmer. They lost everything they had, and trying to survive, he became a carpenter and a woodworker. And yet now he's being sent back to Bethlehem, the home of his origin, to find out why he shouldn't be a farmer. Peasants at the time Jesus was born lived in constant fear for the people and social discontent. That was a way of life. It wasn't something that happened just once in a while. Every day was April 15th to them, never knowing when the government was going to show up and take and take and take and take. When Jesus was born, the birth sacrifice that they were to give was actually the sacrifice of the poverty people. And to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said in the law to the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Not even both, just one or the other, whichever one you can find. Leviticus 15 gives that law, those trying to abide by it. For on the eighth day, you shall take two turtle doves or two young pigeons and come before the Lord under the door of the tabernacle of the congregation and give them unto the priest. Even the priests were so corrupt. The lamb was what was sacrificed for having a baby. But they couldn't afford it. Go find two turtle doves, two young pigeons, and come to the door, knock on the door, and say, here's my sacrifice. What kind of honor was that, having a baby? If they had to do that. But that was the law. They were under the law. I did some study on turtle doves and pigeons. So I found out that the land was overrun by these birds and sold for next to nothing to those who could not catch them for themselves. You had 8 days from the time your baby was born to go catch yourself a couple of turtle doves. And if you were a bad hunter, couldn't get two turtle doves or two young pigeons. All you had to do was go find a nest and take the young birds out of the nest before you even fly. In order to offer a sacrifice at the temple. We come to the third area, which I call religious apathy. Oh yes, there were those who were religiously involved, but not for the most part. The Roman religion was polytheism. You don't like your God, make yourself a new one. The Jewish religion was monotheistic. There was only one God. If you didn't like the way God treated you, just ignore him. In both cases, primarily culture controlled the view of religion. I thought about that quite a bit in preparation for this message. Isn't that what's happening in our country today? Is that happening in our world today? When suddenly the Pope, after all, close to 2,000 years, sanctions homosexuality? And we go on down the line, and you got the money, you sanction divorce. Whatever you want to do, you'll sanction it if you got enough money to pay it. The sad thing is true even in Protestant communities. There are those in the various denominations and churches. Whatever God said, it doesn't really make any difference. You do what you want to do, God will bless you anyway. But the world was changing religiously because some Gentile wise men were coming from the east. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. Notice they did not come to Bethlehem, they went to Jerusalem, the seat of power. Where else would the king be except at the seat of power? Saying, where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. Then Herod the king had heard, when Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled and all Jerusalem with him. I can imagine all Jerusalem was troubled because you see, Herod was a dictator who did what he wanted to, when he wanted to, how he wanted to do it, and everybody in Jerusalem was going to pay the price, some way, shape, or form, because here was authority raising up and might be against him. And when he gathered all the chief priests and scribes and people together, he demanded them worship where Christ should be born. Notice the word demanded. They had an answer or they died. Isn't it great that they had an answer? They said to him, in Bethlehem, Judea, for thus is written by the prophet, but thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. When Herod heard, then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired them diligently, when did the star appear? He gathered his information to be geopolitically correct. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go, search diligently for the young child. And when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship with him also. There was a period of time involved here. Months, maybe even up to 2 years when they start first appearing. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. Being called a young child now, not a baby. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. They didn't get excited about what Herod told them. When they saw the star again, they were excited. When they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, not in the house, not in the manger. Fell down and worshipped him, and when they had opened the treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. When the baby was 8 days, old, they went to the temple and they gave the sacrifice of poor peasants. Now the wise men came and presented to them gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They gave enough wealth to sustain them. I often think about this. You know, how often we have to have an answer to what's going on before the problem even arises. Mary and Joseph left Bethlehem broke. Got to the hometown of Bethlehem. No room in the inn. Mary expecting a baby right now. Not tomorrow, but right now. And they would provide a stable. And now, months have gone by, maybe even as much as 2 years, and he's still in Bethlehem. He did not go back to farm, did not go back to his carpentry shop. He had to figure out some way to survive. And now they're there, all of a sudden, knock comes on the door, and here come these weird guys from some foreign country with all kinds of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and drops it in their hand. He said, here. Can you imagine Joseph? Wow, my God. What's this all about? Being warned of God in a dream, they should not return to Herod. They departed, went their own country another way. And when they had departed, the angel Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise, take the young child and mother and flee at Egypt. And be thou there until I bring thee word. For Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. Interesting. God provided just in time the resources to take care of that family in Egypt till Herod the Great died in 4 AD. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed Egypt. Hey, remember he's in a dream. Wonder what time it was? 1 o'clock in the morning? 2 o'clock in the morning? 3 o'clock in the morning? Mary, that's the other act there. We're out of here. Wonder how she reacted to that. And was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt shall I call my son. Herod the Great quickly became Herod the Frightened. This important man in his late 60s, a creator and a survivor of so much political intrigue, was shaken by the seemingly unimportant birth of a baby. But when you analyze it, understood the political power of religion. After all, this was the man that began the restoration of the temple. As a non-Jew ruler, Herod worried about how his Jewish subject might react to Gentile foreigners coming to his kingdom to worship a Jewish baby. Think about that. His whole life spectrum was geopolitical. Fight whatever fight you got to fight. That at all costs win. So how did he figure it out? And what bothered him even more was this newborn baby was purported to be the subject of scripture. Religious authorities of that day and the Magi confirmed to Herod that a Messiah, a a king of the Jews to be born in Bethlehem, fulfilling ancient Jewish prophecies. Herod had all under control. He was the king of the Jews. Who's this young baby born here, father? That's turmoil in my kingdom. Potential perception that prophecy had been fulfilled was political dynamite. Oh yeah, apathetic, the day is long, but don't let something happen that's going to shake his world. Didn't take too much imagination to see that this child, whoever he was, could spark a movement of people whose ultimate allegiance would be to a kingdom different than his own, thereby subverting his absolute rule. So he acted preemptively, ordering the death of every boy in Bethlehem, under the age of two. But Joseph had already been warned. And by night, he got out of there. He had looked at all the babies. And I wonder how many other children whose parents, all of a sudden when the centurions arrived, going house to house and killing every baby, how many snatched their little one and ran for their, and stood up for their lives. You know, it's interesting, the world has not changed. There's still greedy, power-hungry politicians. There's still many culturally poor who listen to promises they know will not happen. There's still religious bigots in it for themselves and willing to destroy their reputation and financial world for anyone and everyone who will not fall into line with their way of thinking. We're not just to survive, but thrive in this present corruption. We need to remember God is still on the throne, and nothing surprises God. I don't care whether it's a pandemic, it's a change of political powers, it's a loss of jobs and homes. I don't think we have seen even the tip of the iceberg of what's to happen in the next few months. In the news yesterday, I heard how many people are going to lose their homes because they already have lived months without paying their rent. People are going to, the owners are going to claim their property. Rejoice this Christmas regardless. You may not have big family get-togethers, but we can still rejoice because God is still on the throne, the mighty God is He. And He cares for His own throughout all eternity. Be thankful anyway. It may not be what you wanted, but can you be thankful? I'm thankful I didn't live in Jerusalem, in Bethlehem. I'm glad we have so much abundance we think we are privileged, just like the Roman citizens anymore. Even if we lose a little of it, so what? Be thankful anyway. God still has supplied. And he will. Be joyful and be at peace. That's a message we all need to hear, isn't it? Rejoice, be thankful, be at peace. Nothing's going to happen to us that God is aware of. We know all that. I'd like to just share with you something on, not really directly related to this message, but in a way, I call it my three happiest days. The day I knew I was saved. I went through 5 miserable years of every time you were taken, you would go down the aisle. And nobody bothered to tell me that I could know that I was born again. Dr. Malcolm Crunk, Uncle Mel, from the Bible Hour, my pastor at the time at South Baptist Church in Lansing. And I went down 1 week, and the next week I went down again. He looked around the big old truck and was standing there and said, "Young man, didn't I see you down here last week?" I said, "Uh-huh. What you doing, Paul, by the way?" He said he'd save me. And he did. He had. Happiest day of my life, but I knew I did not have to fear God was going to reject me. My second happiest day was I knew what God had put me here on earth to do. You ever kind of wander around and just say, I don't know what I'm supposed to do, I don't know why I'm here? That's great fear. Now the interesting thing was that even though I knew before I was saved what I was here for, I didn't know why I was here to do that. I was only about 7 years old at Hope Baptist Church in its early days, founding, still meeting in the township hall. My grandfather and my brother and I set church up, and then we played church, and I'm up there preaching the book of Revelation at age 7. And what was interesting was my grandfather, when I gave the invitation, raised his hand and accepted the Lord. I know that dear man was already saved, but that affected my life. But you see, there was a third day. The day I quit fighting God and started to do what he told me to do. And I lost the fear of pleasing God. I had that fear that God would reject me. I had the fear that I didn't really have a purpose in life. And the fear of not pleasing God. Accepting that, I don't have to worry about not pleasing God ever again. Psalm 27:1 says this, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" We're going to close today by a song. Okay. take Psalm 27. Thank you very much. Don't forget.